Now, I believe that our principles need to be based on the Bible, not on a creed. But I have a few questions for your consideration. And these questions are to those that believe that Adventism was raised up of God. This is to those that have studied from the Bible those principles and believe them. This is to those that believe themselves Seventh-day Adventists because they believe they are standing on the principles of original Seventh-day Adventism. I want us to take a look at just a few of the principles of faith of the Seventh-day Adventists from 1872. It starts out here, it says that as far as we know, there's entire unanimity among Seventh-day Adventists on these points. So, can there be any question, if this is true, if they're stating the truth here, can there be any question that this is representative of what Seventh-day Adventists believed? Principle one, notice it tells us that concerning God, there's one God, personal spiritual being, creator of all things, etc. Everywhere present, how? By his representative, the Holy Spirit. Now, what I want you to do, if you can somehow keep track, maybe on your hands or something, how many of these you or your group that you're with, how many of these you disagree with? Okay. Number two. And I'm just going to be pointing out a few things here. We're not going to take time to read everything. Took on him the nature of the seed of Abraham, etc. That he lived our what?
Example.
Yes. Died our sacrifice, etc. Just keep track. And I have a question for you afterwards. We object to the view, this was in the footnotes. We object to the view that the atonement was made upon the cross, because it is utterly contrary to the type. There's lots more we could pick out here, but that the Holy Scriptures of the Old and New Testaments were given by inspiration of God, contain a full revelation of his will to man, and are the only infallible rule of faith and practice. The baptism is an ordinance of the Christian Church to follow faith and repentance, an ordinance by which we commemorate the resurrection of Christ, etc. I won't spend a lot of time on that. That the new birth comprises the entire change necessary to fit us for the kingdom of God and consists of two parts. First, the moral change wrought by conversion and a Christian life. Second, a physical change at the second coming of Christ, etc. So, take note, the new birth comprises the entire change necessary to fit us for the kingdom of God. A moral change wrought by conversion and a what? Christian life. Two parts to the first point. Okay? Reading on. That prophecy is a part of God's revelation to man, that it is included in that scripture which is profitable for instruction, that it is designed for us and our children. That's so far from being enshrouded in impenetrable mystery, it is that which especially constitutes the Word of God a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. That a blessing is pronounced upon those who study it, and that consequently it is to be understood by the people of God sufficiently to show them their position in the world's history and the special duties required at their hands. So we are to understand the prophecies. That the world's history from specified dates in the past, the rise and fall of empires, and the chronological succession of events down to the setting up of God's everlasting kingdom are outlined in numerous great chains of prophecy. And that these prophecies are now all fulfilled except the closing scenes. I know some people that take the whole book of Daniel and the whole book of Revelation and try to fit it all in right now and in the future. No problem if you have a biblical basis for that, but don't be claiming to be Seventh-day Adventist while you're doing that. That the world's history from specified dates in the past, etc., all these events down to the setting up of God's everlasting kingdom are outlined in numerous great chains of prophecy, and that these prophecies are now all fulfilled except the closing scenes. That the doctrine of the world's conversion and a temporal millennium is a fable of these last days calculated to lull men into a state of carnal security. Some don't believe there's a temporal millennium, but a temporal century. There's a group that's teaching there's 100 years of peace.
Really?
Yeah. Yes.
With an Adventist?
Yeah. Yeah.
Really?
Yep.
Yeah.
And that the second coming of Christ is to precede, not follow, the millennium. For until the Lord appears, the papal power with all its abominations is to continue. The wheat and tares grow together, and evil men and seducers wax worse and worse, as the Word of God declares. That the mistake of Adventists in 1844 pertained to the nature of the event then to transpire, not to the time. Are you still counting on your fingers? I hope so, because I have a question for you afterwards. That the mistake of Adventists in 1844 pertained to the nature of the event then to transpire, not to the time. That no prophetic period is given to reach to the second advent, but that the longest one, the 2,300 days of Daniel 8:14, terminated in 1844 and brought us to an event called the cleansing of the sanctuary. Hope you're keeping track of how many you believe or disbelieve, one or the other.
Here we go.
That the sanctuary of the new covenant is the tabernacle of God in heaven, of which Paul speaks in Hebrews 8 and onward, and of which our Lord as great high priest is minister, that this sanctuary is the antitype of the Mosaic tabernacle, and that the priestly work of our Lord connected therewith is the antitype of the work of the Jewish priests of the former dispensation, that this and not the earth is the sanctuary to be cleansed at the end of the 2,300 days. What is termed its cleansing being in this case, as in the type, simply the entrance of the high priest into the most holy place to finish the round of service connected therewith by making the atonement and removing from the sanctuary the sins which have been transferred to it by means of the ministration in the first apartment. So there's an atonement being made, starting with 1844. Removing the sins. And that this work in the antitype, beginning in 1844, consists in actually blotting out the sins of believers and occupies a brief but indefinite space of time, at the conclusion of which the work of mercy for the world will be finished and the second advent of Christ will take place. that God's moral requirements, keep track now, that God's moral requirements are the same upon all men in all dispensations. That these are some, what's that? God's moral requirements, what's this talking about? That's right. That these are the same upon all men in all dispensations. That these are summarily contained in the commandments spoken by Jehovah from Sinai, engraven on tables of, on the tables of stone, and deposited in the ark, which was in consequence called the Ark of the Covenant or Testament. That this law is immutable and perpetual, being a transcript of the tables deposited in the ark in the true sanctuary on high, which is also for the same reason called the Ark of God's Testament, for the sounding of the seventh trumpet. These are principles of faith. I'm not asking you to believe any of this stuff just because it's stated in this statement of beliefs. That's not my point here. I want you to know who you are. I want you to know your identity. That's all I'm doing. So keep track. All of these things need to be studied from the Bible, and you need to conclude for yourself if it's true or not from the Bible. But right now I'm just addressing a different point. It says this law is the same in all dispensations. The requirements are the same. And that there is the sounding of the seventh trumpet when the temple of God was opened in heaven, and there was seen in his temple the Ark of his Testament. By the way, if you haven't noticed already, Seventh-day Adventists are a people of prophecy. That the fourth commandment of this law requires that we devote the seventh day of each week, commonly called Saturday, to abstinence from our own labor, etc. This doesn't say that the seventh day is a nice day to keep. It helps us in our Christian walk. It says that the fourth commandment of this law requires that we devote the seventh day of each week. And we saw that the law is binding on all dispensations. Now, if you don't know why I'm emphasizing some of these things, that's fine. But there are wolves that seek to come in among us as a people all over the world. And they try to destroy our faith. And so some of these things have become more prominent and needing more emphasis than others. That as the man of sin, the papacy is thought to change times and laws and has misled almost all Christendom in regard to the fourth commandment. We find a prophecy of reform in this respect to be wrought among believers just before the coming of Christ. And we did look at some similar texts in Isaiah and elsewhere foretelling this reformation that would take place. But this points us to the prophecies we've just been looking at, that the man of sin, the papacy, has thought to change times and laws. We studied this a few days ago. These things that we're looking at, remember, these are not nice things to know. These are a statement of beliefs which identifies a people. This people believe these things. So if you don't believe those things, are you one of those people?
No.
No. I just want that clarified. Keep track. That the followers of Christ should be a peculiar people, not following the maxims, nor conforming to the ways of the world, nor loving its pleasures, etc. that the scriptures insist upon plainness and modesty of attire? And that means for the support of the evangelical work among men should be contributed from love to God and love to souls, not raised by church lotteries and dinners and all this other stuff. That the proportion of one's income required in former dispensations, how much was that?
A tenth.
That the portion of one's income required in former dispensations can be no less under the gospel. That it is the same as Abraham, whose children we are if we are Christ's, paid to Melchizedek when he gave him a tenth of all. The tithe is the Lord's, we read in Leviticus 27:30. And this tenth of one's income is also to be supplemented by offerings from those who are able for the support of the gospel. Notice that this is a statement of beliefs, that the tithing system is still binding. It requires radical transformation of the affections, the exchange of unholy for holy principles, and this transformation follows repentance and faith. Requires the special work of the Holy Spirit, constitutes regeneration or conversion. And we are dependent upon Christ first for justification and also to render acceptable obedience to His holy law. And number 19, that the Spirit of God was promised to manifest itself in the church through certain gifts. What is this talking about? The spirit of prophecy. I hope you're still, maybe you ran out of fingers, I don't know. You can use your toes. That God, in accordance with His uniform dealings with the race, sends forth a proclamation of the approach of the second advent of Christ, and that this work is symbolized by the three messages of Revelation 14. The three angels' messages. The last one, which says they were not to worship the beast or its image or receive its mark. And that's the heart of the message. But it says here that this work is symbolized by the three messages of Revelation 14. The last one bringing to view the work of reform on what? The law of God. Not just a nice thing to do, a nice memorial that you can keep if you want or not. And does the three angels, or where do we find in the last one, what is the last one? The last of the three messages, which angel is that?
Third.
The third. Where do we find in that anything about a work of reform on the law of God? Those that keep the commandments of God. Let's look at Revelation 14. Verse 9. And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God. That's the first mention of the law of God. Because we just saw that the mark of the beast is Satan's mark, that he is thinking to change times and laws. That he's the man of sin. Sin is a transgression of what? The law of God. He has changed the definition of sin. And that's why God calls him the man of sin. When you change the law of God, which the Bible defines a transgression of as sin, you're changing the definition of sin. And God calls it the man of sin. when the papacy did this, God said that they could only think to, because they can't, no one can change God's law. No one can say it's not binding anymore when God says it's perpetual. This shall be a sign between me and you throughout your generations. It will be for a perpetual covenant.
Yes. So what reform are they talking about?
The reform of receiving the seal of God, which we've been talking about. And then verse 12 that was brought out, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. So, on the one hand, those that receive the mark of the beast are brought out, receiving the wrath of God. And then another group is seen, those who keep the commandments of God. The commandments of God is contrasted with those who receive the mark. Because the mark is a violation of the law of God. It's a mark, an institution that stands in direct opposition to the seal of God, which is found in His law. That the time of the cleansing of the sanctuary, synchronizing with the time of the proclamation of the third message. When did that begin? 1844. And the time of the cleansing of the sanctuary synchronizes with that. So it's not some future event. I hope you're still keeping track of how many of these you can not agree with, or that you agree with, whichever's easier to fit on your fingers and toes. But and that it is a time of what?
Investigative
judgment. From when? From 1844, from the time of the proclamation of the third message. First, with reference to the dead, and secondly, at the close of probation, with the reference to the living. That the grave, whether we all tend, expressed by the word Hebrew word shol, etc., is the grave, essentially. That the state to which we are reduced by death is one of silence and activity and entire unconsciousness, so the state of the dead. That out of this prison house of the grave, mankind are to be brought by a bodily resurrection,
Amen.
Which takes place at the second coming. And the wicked, 1,000 years later, and at the last trump, the living righteous are to be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, etc. That these immortalized ones are then taken to heaven, to the New Jerusalem, and they'll be reigning with Christ 1,000 years, etc. That at the end of the 1,000 years, the Lord descends with His people, and the New Jerusalem, and the wicked dead are raised, and finally, the new heavens and the new earth shall spring by the power of God from the ashes of the old. And the new Jerusalem will be its metropolis, etc. We could have emphasized a lot more points, but now my question, I hope you still have kept track. How many are Adventists? And I hope you've reached the same conclusion that I have, that a true Adventist is one who is a Christian. One who is a Bible-believing Christian. As I mentioned, these things are all based on the Bible. And so, I want us to take an honest look at ourselves. Our study tonight, we talked about the mark of the beast. We saw that this was that the third angel brings about a reform, or how did it go? That this works, is symbolized by three messages of Revelation. The last one, the third angel, which warns against receiving the worshiping the image or the beast or receiving its mark, that this third angel brings to view the work of reform on the law of God. How does it do that? By warning against the mark of the beast. So the mark of the beast, the understanding of this, is in the principles of faith of Seventh-day Adventists. So my point is that we can't just say, well, that's your understanding. Well, that's just prophecy. We can all disagree on prophecy. If we're not agreeing with the principles of faith, that's fine. Maybe we've come up with some other conclusions. If it's biblical, then praise the Lord. But we need to sit down and study together and see how we can harmonize, see if one of us is misunderstanding or something. But in the meantime, don't claim to be a Seventh-day Adventist if you don't believe what Seventh-day Adventists teach and taught. And I don't mean Seventh-day Adventist in a corporate sense with your name on the church books, because the Seventh-day Adventist beliefs today are entirely different. It's a new organization. But I'm talking about historic Seventh-day Adventism, the church that God raised up. So, I won't ask for a show of hands how many of these principles you believe or you don't believe or your group believes or doesn't believe, but I want you to think seriously about it. And we need to be considering where we're going, what direction we're headed. And I, for one, I am, I had questions when I was in college, when I was attending Pacific Union College, an Adventist college, and I was studying theology. I reached a point, because of all the paganism I was having to study, and almost no Bible, reached a point where I was questioning, well, are you really there, God? Do you really exist? Mm-hmm. And so I went through those questions, and I came to conclude that there is a God, that He does love us, and that this is the truth. And I studied, and you know what I did for maybe 10 years? I took every commentary, everything written about the Bible, and I trashed it. Well, I put it away, archived it. And I didn't look at anything. I'm not recommending for anybody else to do that. But I wanted to know if this is the truth. Mm-hmm. And I studied my Bible myself. Mm-hmm. And I knew what was taught already. I knew what subjects I needed to look up. I grew up in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. But I was going to be sure myself. And why I came to that point was I got so frustrated attending the college, because there was only one class in 3.5 years of theology major that we even used our Bibles. Mercy. As a theology major. We learned about what so-and-so says about the Bible and what so-and-so says and that person and that person and that commentary, but we didn't learn what God says. We learned philosophy. We learned to think like Aristotle and Plato and Confucius and Socrates and all the rest. We learned how to manipulate minds. We studied Freudian psychology. We studied Greek mythology, and on and on and on.
About what time was that? Mm-hmm.
That was in the 80s, early 80s. Yeah.
David, somewhere today we saw a slide that showed the railroad track, and there was no point made on it, but I remember if that track is off by 1 inch and you go a mile down, It's off by quite a bit.
That's right.
Many yards.
That's right.
That's why the truth has to be so accurate. Mm-hmm.
That's right. And as Pastor Allen said today about it, the track of truth lies very close to the track of truth. What did I say? Anyway, you know what I meant. The track of truth lies very close to the track of error. Thank you. I want us to stop for a moment before I just wrap up my thoughts, because the sun is setting right now, and so I want us to pause for prayer. Our Father in heaven, we have been blessed through this camp meeting by all the speakers and the food that we've received. Yes. And we earnestly pray that as we go from here, we will be filled to the overflowing and be able to share with others and keep in our memories the need to talk about the lessons we've learned, talk about you and share you, and not like Jesus' parents get all caught up with the chatting and the fellowshipping that we forget about Jesus. Mm. And we lose that blessing. So I pray that we can keep this blessing and make it ours. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
My last thought is just that there is a time of trouble coming, brothers and sisters. A time of trouble such as never was. We recently went to Cambodia. And when we went to Cambodia, from the very first entrance into the country, it was a hair-raising experience for me. There were blessings involved, but the immigration officer, when we stepped up to immigration, he shouted in an angry, just the most hateful look on his face, like he wanted to rip us apart. And he was speaking in Cambodian, so we don't even know what he was saying. And we stood there not knowing what to do, and then he got even more angry and just kept shouting in Cambodian. And finally, he said, "I said, get back in line." And he was addressing my wife, because she had come up with me. Usually we go up together, because they take, you know, when you're traveling with someone, a family, then you go together. So we didn't know, but from that moment on, we knew that this was a special place. And we saw, we visited a museum in Phnom Penh that is, it used to be a school, and then it became a prison. One of 175 torture prisons. And we toured through there, and they kept detailed records. They had pictures of everybody. They had photos of each process in their
torture.
It was a torture prison. All 175 prisons were torture prisons. Their purpose in torturing people was simply to extract confessions, so that they could, you know, whether they were true or not, they could have some justification for then killing you. We saw the killing fields. We saw the instruments they killed with, the clothes that the people wore. Because this just happened in recent times. We spoke with the father of the young pastor that we had gone to visit, and he told us about the day that they marched into Phnom Penh. And how he was required to flee, along with everybody else in the city. almost 2 million people. And it was a Holocaust. And almost a third of the people died. And many of those, a large portion of them, were tortured first. There was an Australian, along with other foreigners, this happened to, but the Australian was on a sailboat, sailing around the world, enjoying life. He happened to be within the waters of Cambodia when Pol Pot marched his army into Phnom Penh. They sent boats out, captured him, sent him to S-21. I've got pictures of him. He was never heard from again. But some of the records there show his confessions that his captain or colonel was Colonel Sanders of Kentucky Fried Chicken fame. They had to think of something. They had to think of something in order to escape by death. As long as they didn't confess to anything, the torture went on, and it went on for weeks and weeks. His mother's telephone number was his ID number. And, you know, he had nothing to say because he was just a kid that was sailing around the world to have fun. And they accused him, of course, of being a spy to destroy the revolution and stuff. But these things were done by the world against the world. There were religious people involved. 25,000 monks, Buddhist monks, perished.
Did the United Nations ever respond to this?
Pol Pot died in peace in 1997 at his own house. For the last year, he was under house arrest in a beautiful, beautiful home. And for 10 years after the Vietnamese liberated the country, he was supported by the United Nations and the United States and funded to continue guerrilla operations against the government that he had just been deposed from. It's a horrible story, horrific. But this was the world against the world. This was not wartime deaths. Between 2 and 3 million people were killed, which was, like I say, close to a third of the population of the country during a three and a half year period. And these people were not killed in war. These were normal citizens, men, women, children. If you wore glasses, you were assumed to be an educated person and a threat. So you were tortured and killed. If you were a doctor, a lawyer, a teacher, any professional was thrown in prison and killed. Hunger set in. And people that were caught picking a banana were killed. First, they were verbally abused and brutally beaten and tortured. And when I looked at the figures, and maybe you've received a recent newsletter that we sent out, which depicted all of these things, the numbers of casualties that governments have killed of their own people, not counting wartime deaths, I have documented there in the millions upon millions upon millions. And we're told that we are facing a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation.
Mm-hmm.
That's right. And we are going to go through on a worldwide scale what France went through during the French Revolution, we're told. We're warned about all, you know, in all these different ways about what we're facing in the world. And I don't want to be without Christ at that time. You know, the pen can't portray the things that are coming upon the world. There may be persecution. We know there's going to be persecution. We may have to suffer for our faith. But at least we die with Christ. At least we go through the troublous times knowing that Jesus is by our side. And that we're going to be resurrected. But what are you going to do when, because you purchase your peace for a few extra days or weeks by compromise, what are you going to do when you're being tortured and killed anyway? It's not worth it. You know, I don't want to scare anybody, but this is a fact of life. You're going to die if you go along with the world. You may die if you go along with Christ. But if you die with Christ, you've got an eternal life ahead of you. And you have peace in your heart while you're dying. And He gives you grace to endure the persecution. Brothers and sisters, I want to die with Christ.
If we do
die. If
I need to die. Nothing can touch us as long as we have a work to do. There's a brother that I've only communicated with by internet that studied himself into this message, believes the truth about God. An Adventist. He's running a missionary school in Mindanao. And he's right in the thick of the battle. He was kidnapped at one point. And recently, a few months ago, he was taken by the military and interrogated for 4 hours. And they assumed that he must have something to do with the rebels, with the communist rebels, because he's not being molested right now. He's been there like 10 years. And they said, how can you live up there for all this time and they're not demanding of you what they call revolution taxes? They're not molesting you. They're not burning your houses, your belongings. How can you live up there in peace like that for all this time? You must be connected with them. And he said, no, I'm not. I serve, whether the people are in this political realm or that political realm, I don't get into politics. And anyway, they're keeping record of all his emails and things now. But he said, nothing can touch me until my time has come. He's in the States right now. He really wanted to come to this camp meeting. And he already, when he learned about it, he already had a ticket that's supposed to fly out Monday from another state, and he had packing to do and things that he just couldn't see how he could arrange things. But he said, I long for believers of like faith to fellowship with. And so keep him in your prayers. And if you want to say hello, to have me tell him hello for you or something, I'll be happy to do that. Let him know that he's not alone, that we're praying for him.
Hello.
And his name is Mike Cordes. And
so this is in the Philippines?
Yeah. Yeah. I haven't met him yet because he's on the northeastern edge of Mindanao. We were in Mindanao for almost 2 months, just a few months ago, but we didn't get on that side of Mindanao. It's a pretty large island. And but anyway, there are people that are sacrificing, laying down their lives for the truth, putting their life on the line, like this brother that we don't even know about. And God is working upon hearts all over the world. And so I was going to say something else about him, but he asked me a question by email a few weeks ago. He asked, how do you understand Revelation 18? How about this issue? Should we be still trying to work in the church? Or what should we do? And he said, I'm just not sure. And I was, I had just about 30 seconds at, I forget just where I was, checking internet, because we don't have internet at home. So I told him, I just sent him a quick note, I'll answer you later. Because I needed to take the time, which I didn't have at the time, to share a study with him on that. But anyway, keep him in your prayers. And I want to ask Pastor Allen, he has a thought to share at this time, and then we'll have a closing prayer after that.
The truth of the matter is that after that, I have a lot more things I want to say. And I'd like to say that, yes, I am a Seventh-day Adventist.
Amen.
And I just got an email in. I just noticed it quickly. And it was on a presentation I had made on a YouTube video. And it said that they were disappointed in the shallowness of my study, that I had left the fundamental principles of Adventism because I was not supporting the 2520 prophecy. But according to the fundamental you read to us tonight, the pioneers believed that the 2300 days was the longest time prophecy of the Bible.
Yeah.
I'd just like to repeat a statement that was read this morning to those who came to the early meeting. If you didn't come, you missed out. This is from 1MR228. God's purpose in giving the third angel's message to the world is to prepare a people to stand true to him during the investigative judgment. That's what it's about. So many of you have made my week a lot better week. And you've come and you've blessed me by your presence. And I want to thank each one of you for doing that. A special thanks to Josh, who's helped run the camera a lot, and that's a time-consuming and dedicated job that you have to commit to. I appreciate that, Josh. I appreciate Brother Caleb helping out with the music so much, and all the others who have done anything to make this easier. Sister Raquel tackled one of the largest jobs we have by providing the Sabbath meal, and she had a lot of good help, and I can't thank everyone, but all those workers who worked with her, and Todd and Rhonda had a lot of the youth and everyone. Sister Sandy, she took some of the little ones, and everyone has had a part, it seems like, in something somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
I've been blessed. It's been, as Brother Morgan said earlier, the fastest camp meeting I've ever been through that actually was physically this long. It's been a great camp meeting. I hope you've been blessed by it. I would like to apologize for my failures, where I've not done enough or been kind enough or worked hard enough for you this week. But I love each one of you, and I hope that we're never back here again like this. I hope that the work closes out and that we can go home this next year.
Mm.
Wouldn't that be better? Wouldn't that be better than saying, I want to see you all next year here? I want to see you in heaven soon.
Amen.
I don't know. We are people of prophecy. I can't tell you how long the last days are going to be. I can't tell you how long the close of probation is going to last and how long we will live without an intercessor. There's different ideas. It may not be very long. We might be in heaven in a year, and it might be a little more. But you know, God is consistent, friends. Ellen White wrote a letter to I believe it was to P.T. McGann, and she said, we may have to be on this world many more years for insubordination. She wrote that in 1901. We may have to be here for more years because of insubordination. We can have insubordination in a lot of ways. But I want to tell you, I believe with all my heart in doctrinal integrity.
Amen.
I believe in pure doctrine.
Mm-hmm.
I believe that the teachings matter.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe that deviations from even one of these principles that we had tonight is apostasy.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to face the fact that in this movement we call the Godhead movement, there is a serious amount of deviation.
Mm-hmm.
I think if some people were honest, and it may not be people here tonight, but there's people that I know of, that if they were honest, they would count many fingers worth mm-hmm. of statements, because we think, well, this person is just off on this one statement because he just has said this or she has believed that. We need to understand, friends, that theology is like it's a puzzle that all fits intertwined together, building one statement upon another. And yes, some people have called it systematic, and I do believe in systematic theology. I believe the Bible teaches it, because you have foundational doctrines that everything else is based upon.
Mm-hmm.
I had quite an education several years ago. Some of you know that I've never attended seminary. I'm not like Pastor David. I didn't have to learn Plato and those things. But I was pastoring in the mainline church, and we had a Bible worker who was working with our church, and he was cleaning out his trailer one day, getting rid of some things. And he said, oh, I've got something you might be interested in. I said, what is it? He said, well, it's my theology notes from Norman Golly's class. I said, well, I'd like to see those. And he had these systematic theology notes. And in that class, and Norman Golly today is probably considered still the authority within Adventism on systematic theology. He's written a large multi-volume series on systematic theology, and it's published, and a lot of people read it and use it, even that aren't Adventists necessarily. But he said that everything we teach is based upon two other things. One is the nature of Christ, and the other is the nature and your understanding of sin.
Mm-hmm.
And as I went through his notes and saw the teachings of Norman Golly and how he was using these concepts, I could see where he was using these and building and building and building and building. And he was coming up with ideas that were not in accordance with these fundamentals that we've been discussing tonight. But of course, we've left a lot of these fundamentals. As I shared with those of you who were here on Wednesday morning, we studied chains of prophecy. We used to believe that the man of sin was the papacy, right?
Mm-hmm.
What is the current fundamental in Adventism on the man of sin now? Zero. It doesn't exist. What is our current position on the mark of the beast now? Zero. It doesn't exist. So you can say, well, you know, I can't expel someone from Adventism because they've changed their view of prophecy on the mark of the beast, because actually, you know, we don't have a statement on the mark of the beast. Friends, they may not have a statement on the mark of the beast.
The Bible.
But the people that I want to associate with, the people that I want to work with, have great unanimity. As far as I know, entire unanimity on this point. And it's an important point. And if you drop it, you may as well drop everything. Because the third angel's message was to prepare people to be able to stand in the time of the investigative judgment. Right? I hope that we don't come back next year. But if we do, may we come back with hearts that love God more fervently, with desires to work more earnestly, and may we, friends, this next year, claw, scratch, do whatever we need to do to make this message go forward.
Amen.
Amen. If any of you need me for anything, I'll try to make myself available tonight. I know some of you may be leaving even tonight. I don't know if anyone's taking out tonight, but usually there's always a few. You're welcome to stay as long as you need to. If you want to stay till Sunday or Monday, we'll be doing a lot of cleanup tomorrow, and that's fine. If you want to stay and help, we'd be happy for that. But you're welcome here at Smyrna. You're welcome. And if I have seemed not congenial enough or shown hospitality enough, I apologize, and I know I've been busy, and I know I've had a few things on my mind at times. And so I apologize if I've not given some of you the individual attention and detail I should have. But I'm glad for everyone who's come, whoever you are. I'm glad for everyone who's come. I want you to feel welcome here, but I don't welcome every theology here. And I don't apologize for that.
Amen.
The theology of the man of sin is not welcome here. The theology of New Adventism is not welcome here. Not as long as I'm pastor. Not as long as the people who support Smyrna Gospel Ministries here and who love these truths, love these truths that our pioneers gave us at great expense. May God have mercy on us. Pastor David, I think, was going to have a closing prayer. Okay, I'll have a prayer then. Let's kneel. Heavenly Father, tonight we come to a very bittersweet time. For those of us who have been preparing for this camp meeting and participating in this camp meeting and looking forward to great things, we have been so blessed. And I know that there's always a certain level of exhaustion that those who are here and have been here for the weeks prior feel. And there's almost a certain point of a sigh of relief at this point. But Father, your work's going to go on, and we must go on with it. And we ask that you will continue to give us strength and grace and fortitude. We expect persecution from the world. We expect the world to turn on us. But we want to be faithful to you, Father. We want to be faithful to one another of our brothers and sisters here. We want to be able to stand fast in Christ for them as well as for ourselves. We don't want to betray them to civil authorities, but neither do we want to betray them theologically to the man of sin and to Satan. So please bless us, Father. Give us open minds, pure hearts, willing spirits, that we might know how to rightly divide your word, that we might rightly know our present duty. Our present duty, Father. Many will be traveling in the next 24 hours and even beyond. And I ask that you will go with each and every one. I've heard no reports of any injuries or any great calamities in coming to the camp meeting, even minor ones. And I pray that everyone that's leaving and taking trips, and I know that Pastor Dave and his family, I'm not sure how long they're in the States, maybe a little longer, maybe a month, I don't know, maybe they're going back next week, but they have a long way to go. I've never been quite so far as the Philippines, but I know it's a long way. It's hard travel, and I pray your special blessing upon your servant, Father. Bless his ministry in a mighty way. Bless his wife, his children. Bless the work. Bless his little home up on that mountain right now. That your angels and the way that you impress his neighbors and others will continue to protect it, no matter what is in it or not. That you will keep them safe from the guerrillas, the warlords and the drug dealers and all the people that may try to destroy and hurt people. We pray the same for all of our others that will be traveling. Brother John Christophe has a long way to France, Elvis to Curacao, and others are traveling to Canada and parts of the States and wherever we're at. That you will go with us and keep us and protect us. But Father, if our hearts were to ever take a change, do not allow us to live until that day. Lay us to rest before we would ever turn away from you, Father. Fill us with your love. And we love you, Father. We love Jesus. We praise you, Father, and we praise Jesus tonight. We thank you for the ministry of the heavenly angels. We thank you for being who you are. We thank you for calling us to be a part of the Advent people, the Seventh-day Adventist people. Father, I know that we haven't really scratched the cover of prophecy this week. We've looked at some of the main highlights, it's true. And I think there was one small discussion on Revelation 10. And I was thinking about this, Father, and as this brother was sharing, and I thought, you know, there's a whole chapter here dedicated to our movement. And think of all the great things that are in the Protestant Reformation. But even that whole great movement as a whole wasn't prophesied about as much as this little, what we call, Advent movement. And helped me to gain a better and more clear and valuable perspective of how you view this movement, Father. So please bless us that we will carry this movement forward pure, that we will be willing to sigh and cry for the abominations that try to take this truth away from us. And we thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.